The Supreme Court just heard oral arguments on whether a company could fire a trans person solely because they're transgender. That's right, today we're covering maybe the most controversial aspect of one of the most controversial political arguments of the day. The jokes, well, they just write themselves. Here I am thinking that I'd have to wait until Thanksgiving to hear an uncomfortable debate on this issue. Now recently, the Supreme Court actually heard two back-to-back arguments about whether first you can fire an individual for being homosexual and then immediately afterward transgendered. Thanks for stacking those two debates right on top of each other, Chief Justice Roberts. Really made for a fun and uplifting court-watching experience. You couldn't have just, you know, stuck in a copyright case somewhere in the middle, lighten the mood a little bit? Nope, no chaser for this one. Now on my last episode about whether you can fire an employee for being a homosexual, I asked viewers if they wanted me to cover this debate as well, and several of you, well, you wrote in affirmatively, so here we are. Thank you for participating. Much like the last episode, the Supreme Court will be releasing their decision in February, so this is another cliffhanger episode. Will this minority group get their rights? Tune in next time to find out. My goal today is to listen to the case and summarize the arguments from both sides. Now, I have to admit with this one, this case was pretty all over the place, and boy, I am not gonna try to get on anyone's bad side. So it took a little longer to write this than normal. I mean, I'm working on a Sunday. Now, this is a good summary of the main arguments made in the case, but there are definitely some shiny object tangents that I'm not gonna drag you down. Before we get into the actual arguments though, let's get some background. Now I realize that I'm stepping into a real pronoun minefield in this one, so let's get to the Hurt Locker and start talking. Basically, a woman who was formerly known as Anthony Stevens but is now going by Amy Stevens got hired by a funeral parlor because they thought she was a cisgendered man. Then she decided to start wearing female clothes and planned on getting an operation to remove her male private parts, which resulted in her being fired. Phew, he sticks the landing. I hope. Scroll to the comments to learn why that's wrong. With this context, let's get to the actual case.
We'll hear argument next in case 18107, R.G. and G.R. Harris, Funeral Homes versus the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission.
Much like the last episode, there's one important document being debated in this Supreme Court case. Specifically, the Civil Rights Act of 1964, which prohibits employer discrimination because of race, color, religion, sex, or national origin. Some of you may have noticed that transgender is not a protected category. So the question the court was facing was largely twofold. First, does the protected sex category protect transgendered individuals? And second, if we say it does, is it gonna just burn down the entire system with regard to sex-specific requirements in the workplace? This would include gendered bathrooms, dress codes, women's shelters, and sexually segregated sports teams. Yeah, this debate turned into a bit of a Marvel Cinematic Universe of legal transgender concerns. Before we get into the downside risks of the potential ruling though, let's talk about why this could be a legal problem. There were three similar legal defenses for transgender individuals in this case, with varying degrees of offensiveness. I'm going to focus on the main one. The main argument was, and progressives brace yourself for this one, firing a transgender individual is gender stereotyping.
And at the end of the day, the objection to someone for being transgender is the ultimate sex stereotype. It is saying, I object to you because you fail to conform to this stereotype. The stereotype that if you are assigned a male sex at birth, you must live and identify for your entire life as a man.
Interestingly, the main arguments of this case stemmed from two different interpretations of a Supreme Court case from the 80s, Price Waterhouse v. Hopkins. That's right, this monumental sexual harassment decision was brought to you by PricewaterhouseCooper. They don't settle. Out of court. Now this case dealt with a woman who was looked over for promotions because she was deemed too aggressive. In their decision, the justices from back then wrote, In the specific context of sex stereotyping, an employer who acts on the basis of a belief that a woman cannot be aggressive, or that she must not be, has acted on the basis of gender. It didn't help that being aggressive was considered an asset in male employees. So, at this point, you're probably wondering, how is this going to tie back into transgendered individuals? And bracing yourself because, well, it seems like this argument is going to be about as woke as Rip Van Winkle. First, the progressive argument.
In firing her for failing to conform to its owner's explicitly stated stereotypes about how men and women should behave, it discriminated against her in the same way that Price Waterhouse discriminated against Ann Hopkins for failing to walk and talk more femininely.
Yeah, much like it's discrimination to say that all women need to act feminine, it's just as discriminatory to expect a biologically male woman in your workplace can't act and expect to be treated as female. The logic here would dictate that you can't just fire someone you were originally hired as a male because they no longer conform to your gender stereotypes. And you know what? I think I have to go back to the progressive lawyer explaining it because I'm starting to see some cracks on this thin piece of ice I find myself standing on.
How in the world can the court interpret Title VII to say that Ann Hopkins can't be fired for being insufficiently feminine, but my client can be fired for being insufficiently masculine? There's no textual basis for drawing that distinction whatsoever, and that's because our argument rests on text meaning, at a minimum, sex assigned at birth or biological sex, and everybody.
To go back to the PricewaterhouseCooper case that brought us this dynamic of illegal gender stereotypes, well, the conservative lawyers argue that progressives are misapplying the precedent. In that case, for males, being aggressive was an attribute, while aggressive females, she's overcompensating for being a woman and needs to go to charm school. The 80s were just such a charming decade. In that case, justices were comparing an aggressive man to an aggressive woman and getting different outcomes. Clear enough. In this case, though, progressives were comparing a cisgendered woman to a transgendered woman and getting different outcomes. Again, it's not seeming too illogical yet. Where are you going with this one, Stephen? Well, conservatives would say that the problem emerges when you think about the overall argument that we're trying to figure out. Right now, we're trying to figure out if firing someone who's transgender is a crime. So proving that someone was fired because they're transgendered, well, it isn't really the mic drop moment most of you were probably expecting. Conservatives would apply the precedent differently.
The place that stereotypes come up are when you're figuring out whether similarly situated, whether two people are in fact similarly situated. An aggressive man, take Price Waterhouse, an aggressive man is similarly situated to an aggressive woman. They have the exact same trait, aggressiveness, and the only difference is that stereotypical view that women shouldn't be aggressive. But a transgender man and a cisgender man do not ever share the same trait in the first place, because one identifies with his biological sex, the other identifies with the opposite of his biological sex.
Using their logic, if you would fire a transgender woman as quickly as you would fire a transgender man, well, that's A-OK, because you're treating both genders equally. The question in this case really became whether treating everybody like their biological gender and punishing them if they didn't comply is gender stereotyping. Boo! Or alternatively, if you're treating all transgender people, a group not currently protected under federal employment laws, equally badly for the sole purpose of transphobia is what's actually happening. Interestingly enough, in this case, indiscriminate discrimination is a position that has more solid legal ground to stand on. This is why progressives have had to lean heavily on the stereotype angle. The progressive response to this is very effective, but oh man, would you get banned from every LGBTQ bar in America for making it.
I think one could argue just the opposite, that there is another trait in Price Waterhouse, and the trait is conformity to traditional gender roles. So your argument would suggest, no, we shouldn't look at the aggressive woman and the aggressive man. We should instead say, no, there is this other thing, which is conformity to gender roles.
Right.
We should really look at whether the employer treats the same the aggressive woman and the docile man, the docile effeminate man. And if the employer treats the aggressive woman in the same way that the employer treats the effeminate man, they're both fired, mm-hmm. then the employer is off the hook. Now, you yourself say that that's not right, that in fact, right. that's double discrimination and the employer is on the hook twice.
Warned you. Firing a transgender woman is being compared to firing a male who isn't sufficiently masculine. Talk about an understatement. Around the time when she changed her name, started telling me to refer to her as a woman, and wanted gender reassignment surgery, I really stopped getting that masculine vibe from her. That came up probably more times than you probably would suspect or hope in these arguments. The question really fell upon whether someone was being fired because they were transgendered, which, well, I guess that's fine, or because they weren't complying with gender stereotypes, which, that's gender discrimination. And this brings us to the bigger picture argument that, whoo man, did some justices have opinions on. This argument was first introduced by Neil Gorsuch.
I'm with you on the textual evidence. It's close, okay? We're not talking about extra textual stuff. We're talking about the text. It's close. A judge finds it very close. At the end of the day, should he or she take into consideration the massive social upheaval that would be entailed in such a decision and the possibility that Congress didn't think about it?
So,
and that that is more appropriate in legislative rather than a judicial function. That's it. It's a question of judicial modesty.
Massive social upheaval? I think you're grossly overestimating the number of transgendered people in this country and what'll happen if you gave them basic protections. So why is making it illegal to fire a trans individual gonna lead to a social revolution? Well, if you expand this stereotype law, you would be expanding anybody's legal ability to claim to be another gender and get all sorts of benefits. Of course, this conversation started where else but bathrooms. This is an argument between the conservative lawyer and Justice Breyer about whether, upon this new stereotype logic, any biological male could sue for injury if rejected access to a female bathroom.
Justice Breyer, that is incorrect, because when a biological male is refused access to the women's restroom, mm-hmm. the male would say that was an injury.
Yes, of course
hurt.
He would say,
and there is no BFOQ.
And the other side would say, I'm sorry, but there are serious injuries on the other side. And therefore, it is a BFOQ. Okay? And so, this is not that case. We do not have to decide it. And I don't see why or how you can assume the answer and then build your argument on an answer that I certainly haven't given.
This was a real issue for the justices. As while this case was specifically about whether you could fire someone for being transgendered, it could be more broadly interpreted as, can any employee sue for injury if you force them to act like their biological gender? Let's just say you're TGI Friday's manager and you have a biologically male employee that shows up in a female's uniform. If you make him change, are you forcing him to comply with gender stereotypes? Here's the conservative attorney making that argument.
Under my friend's stereotyping logic, it is always illegal stereotyping to apply sex-specific policies based on biological sex. And that's why he's wrong to say this case isn't about showers and overnight facilities and sports. Every single one of those is impacted if you're talking about a sex-specific policy. What Title VII says is that sex-based differentiation is not the same as sex discrimination.
Now, I realize that, well, this might be more like diet mass social upheaval, but it would still represent a rebalancing of power between employer and employees regarding sex-specific requirements. Of course, complaining that social progress will happen too quickly isn't really a legal argument, it's more what a boomer would complain about in the comments section of this video. What's at the core of this concern is a worry that such a complex and controversial change in regulations should be handled by a 400-page act passed by elected representatives in Congress, as opposed to the Supreme Court. They'd be able to handle all the nuances of balancing employer rights and religious freedoms, as well as trans rights, in a way that a Supreme Court decision just couldn't. The challenge here, of course, is that, well, this is probably not what will be decided here, unless Justice Gorsuch decides to get super woke and start writing the most liberal decision possible. The argument that this was not being litigated here was twofold. First, you still need to prove injury, and while being fired is clearly a substantial injury, I mean, that's the worst case scenario for employment, being forced to use the bathroom or wear the uniform of your biological gender are varying degrees of injury that would require their own litigation and tests.
I understood you to say, maybe I didn't understand you correctly, that if your client had been fired for using the woman's bathroom, that would be a violation of Title VII.
So what I said was, yes, that in our view, were we litigating that case here, which we aren't, they admitted that the restroom was a hypothetical issue and not a reason why she was fired. But were we litigating that case, I think the question would be not whether the policy was because of sex, which is the question here, because obviously the restroom is because of sex. The question would be, does imposing that restroom policy, which is obviously because of sex, impose a discriminatory injury on an individual?
Now, before some of you dismiss this concern entirely, as conservatives will be conservatives, and clearly this case is only about someone being fired, well, the problem is that even if that's true, no matter the outcome, this case is probably going to be the PricewaterhouseCoopers-style backbone for the next trans rights debate. Justice Sotomayor put it best with her more moderate concern.
And what in the law will guide judges in balancing those things? That's really what I think the question is about.
Well, that is a question, Justice Sotomayor. It is not the question in this case.
Mr. Cole, that's yes, so, because once we decide the case in your favor, then that question is inevitable.
So maybe this case isn't the be-all, end-all of trans rights cases, but it's going to set the precedent and the tone for all these future cases that everybody knows are coming down the pipeline. You can bet your hat that when they're writing this decision, they're going to be picking their words more carefully than a poet. It's going to be like a 40-page legalese haiku. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello, YouTube. I'm proud to announce that I just opened up a Patreon account, and special thanks to Yin Centeno for becoming my first patron. If you want to join, there's a link in the description. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news looking into the legal arguments of the day, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.